Minion is going to take us through the protections that fall under the Violence Against Women Act, VAWA. Before she does, I did just want to make a comment, a clarifying comment. I mentioned to you earlier that when I talk about domestic violence, my sort of shorthand for it is that I refer to survivors with female pronouns, and I refer to perpetrators with male pronouns. And I do that as a sort of shorthand because the reality is that domestic violence is often a crime of gender violence. And so, overwhelmingly, that's the dynamic that we see. But I want to make it clear that domestic violence happens to people of all genders. It happens in same-sex relationships. And in fact, there are heightened risks of domestic violence in certain situations involving same-sex couples. And that men can also be abused by female perpetrators. And I say that because as landlords or property managers, I don't want you to fall into the trap of assuming that domestic violence only happens to women, because ultimately you will be on the hook for domestic violence discrimination whether the survivor is a man, a woman, or identifies with a different gender, and same with the perpetrator. So domestic violence does not always look the same. The gendered language that I use is definitely just my own shorthand. And so I appreciate you giving me some grace to use that shorthand. It makes it a lot quicker to talk about these issues, but I don't want you to fall into the trap of thinking that that is the only way that domestic violence happens. So I'm gonna hand it off to Megan. She's gonna wrap up our domestic violence conversation.
All right. So we already discussed Chapter 90, which is the domestic violence protections that apply under Oregon law. Since almost everybody in this room deals with some sort of federal subsidy, you also need to be aware of VAWA protections. VAWA does not apply if there are no federal subsidies at play. This is a list of, in 2013, VAWA was reauthorized and clarified which programs are subject to VAWA. And is a very long list that includes, like you see in the bottom, the low-income housing tax credit program, as well as most other forms of federal subsidies. So VAWA protections apply to specific tenants. Any tenant covered in subsidized housing who is a survivor of DV, dating violence, sexual assault, or stalking, and any affiliated individuals. So you remember in Oregon, they talk about, they use different terms. Here we have qualified individuals. Need to be related by blood or marriage, essentially, or if the victim stands in loco parentis, which is like stands in the shoes of a parent. So pretty much blood and marriage for the most part is the key. Also, anybody who lives in the survivor's household would also be covered. So that's a little different than Oregon law. And like Rebecca was just discussing, it's not limited in any way to women, even with the misnomer of the Violence Against Women Act. For the most part, the non-discrimination provisions track each other under Oregon law and federal law in terms of admissions and terminations, with a few differences and exceptions that we're gonna highlight. Under federal law, you can evict a survivor in limited circumstances, both the housing provider or the housing authority, if there is an actual and imminent threat to other tenants or employees at the property if the victim is not evicted or terminated. So in legalese, actual and imminent threat is a pretty high threshold to meet. And so if this is something you are going to consider, I would actually encourage you to speak with a supervisor and ideally an attorney to see if you're at that threshold requirement. It's much higher than what's even required under the 24-hour notice provisions in Oregon law. We get a definition. HUD defines it as physical danger that is real, would occur within an immediate time frame, and could result in death or serious bodily harm. So you see that's a pretty high standard to meet. And it should only be taken, an eviction proceeding should only be commenced if no other action could be taken to reduce or limit the threat. So bifurcation also comes up under VAWA, just like it does under Oregon law. It gets triggered in different situations though. So 24-hour notice is not necessarily the trigger here. It's anybody who engages in criminal acts or violence against a co-tenant, affiliated individual, or others can be evicted or terminated from the lease. And you would keep the survivor on the lease. So same basic concept of bifurcating the lease, splitting it, and taking somebody off. The difference here, though, is that you might then have, you know, maybe the leaseholder and the person who was eligible for the subsidy, not so much for tax credit purposes, but for other programs, like a voucher or HUD-subsidized housing, they may not be eligible to receive the housing assistance. So the provider or the housing authority would have to give that person an opportunity to apply and be screened for the housing assistance. If the tenant cannot establish eligibility for whatever reason based on that admin plan and the policies for that particular housing provider, then they need to give the person reasonable time to find new housing or to establish eligibility under a different program. So it's much softer requirement, much softer language that you see under VAWA than you would under Oregon law, and something really to keep in mind the differences there. But that is a big thing, is like, does this person still qualify for housing if you have evicted the leaseholder who was the person that received the subsidy? Any questions about bifurcation? Okay. So transfers, this is one of the biggest differences between Oregon law and VAWA or federal law, is that domestic violence survivors can and are entitled to transfer to another unit. So there's emergency transfer plans that should exist that you should have access to through your particular property management company or through the housing authority you're working with. And essentially, those plans allow a survivor to transfer to another unit under a covered housing program, so the same covered housing program, if the tenant requests the transfer, and either the tenant reasonably believes that she is at risk of imminent harm from further violence if she remains at her current unit, or the tenant is a victim of sexual assault that occurred on the premises of the current unit within the last 90 days. In those situations, a victim, a survivor would be entitled to ask for a transfer to the next available unit. The transfer plan needs to have confidentiality measures. Just like under Oregon law, these things need to be kept confidential. Most importantly, you would not want to disclose the new unit to the abuser. So like I said, HUD has created a model plan for use. As far as I'm aware, IRS has not yet. But most tax credit properties end up using the HUD plan in those situations. Yeah, go ahead.
We had a situation where we have a very small complex.
Mm-hmm.
She moved two apartments away. Parking spot was just one over. I mean, how does that protect her if the abuser can see where a car is parked and knows?
I can't say for sure. Most often what's seen is somebody changes complexes. They don't change units, or it's a bigger complex.
Yeah.
But it's really up to the survivor, right? And what they think is going to make them more safe. And so if it's something about that unit and getting out of that unit, even if he's aware of what her car is, that's her choice. Any other questions? Are people familiar with the transfer process under VAWA? This is a new info, right? Okay. When do you know as a housing provider or a housing authority when or when not to provide the VAWA protections that are available to a survivor? It can be based just on the tenant statement, which is a little bit different than Oregon law. A housing provider could request that a certification that the tenant is a survivor when they seek VAWA protection. They would need to do that in writing. Acceptable forms of certification include the VAWA certification form that I think you're all familiar with, documentation signed by a victim service provider, an attorney, medical or mental health professional that attests under penalty or perjury to his or her belief that the tenant is a victim of abuse. That's different language and different requirements than what's under Oregon law. It's a little bit higher of a standard, but the same kind of people, victim service providers and attorneys. And then, of course, any kind of court order or administrative record that is enough to verify that the person is a survivor will suffice. So there's a certain timeline under VAWA that folks need to be aware of. If you do request a certification in writing, then the tenant or applicant has 14 business days to respond to the request, not just normal days. If the tenant does not do that within 14 business days, then the housing authority may pursue the proposed action. So for example, in the case of evictions or termination notices. So conflict certifications, and this gets a little bit to what we were dealing with earlier. So VAWA has a specific procedure to follow if you are getting certifications from both tenants that they're survivors. You can request that the party submit some sort of third-party documentation, and they have 30 days to do that. And so at that point, that's a situation where a landlord actually can put the onus on the tenant to get the court order or copy of the court order and bring that to you. So in VAWA land, that would be okay. Under Oregon law, it's a little bit more of a nuanced stance that you would need to do with that particular survivor, and you don't have the right to put the onus on them to certify when you have these conflicting certifications. Does that make sense? Yeah.
So if you are in, if you're managing a property that would be covered by VAWA, and VAWA conflicts with the state law, which takes precedence, like in this situation.
I wouldn't say they conflict, it just VAWA has higher standards, and so you would need to follow.
Okay.
The Oregon law doesn't have anything about what to do with these conflicting certifications.
Right.
VAWA does, so you would follow VAWA in that case.
So you would follow whichever one has the stricter standards.
I don't know if you could say that for sure in every scenario. I don't want to give that kind of general statement. In the scenario you just brought up, if you would want to just follow the requirements under VAWA, because there's no liability for you under Oregon law if you don't follow it, because there is no requirement. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I had a question. So if someone has a restraining order from 5 years ago and there's no new evidence that they're being released or anything else, but it's 5 years ago and they still want to change units,
mm-hmm.
and trying to use the VAWA from the restraining order 5 years ago, would you in fact do the VAWA for them, or would you reject it because it's nothing within the last 90 days? No change within the last 90 days of anything.
Yeah, so the VAWA doesn't have the 90-day requirement. That's
okay.
Oregon specific.
Okay.
So if you are dealing with VAWA, then you wouldn't be dealing with those kinds of timelines, and you're just getting that certification form from the tenant. You can ask for the additional documentation, and then they would give that. So if they give an order from 5 years ago,
mm-hmm.
as far as I'm aware, that would suffice under VAWA.
Okay. That's amazing.
Which is different than Oregon.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Does the VAWA supersede like wait lists and stuff like that? If you have somebody who needs an emergency transfer, but I'm sure everybody has wait lists for their affordable housing properties. So do they go to the top of the list or?
Usually, but the emergency transfer plan, that's, if you don't have one, you'd want to look at the HUD's model plan, and they would have how you deal with that. There might, if it's just a normal wait list, probably the survivor would go to the top. You might want to be cautious when it's like a reasonable accommodation request that is pending for a transfer as well. Then you want to look and see what the HUD plan has, and if they don't have the answer, then consult with an attorney at that point. But usually if you're just a normal potential applicant, the person's going to go above everybody of those normal potential applicants. Any other questions?
We had one where we had a VAWA and she went to the top of the list.
Yeah.
And I was in the middle of screening somebody else and I still had to bump them out and say,
right.
Sorry.
Not at this time.
As long as she's still qualified, she used to pass the screening and all
mm-hmm.
that.
Yeah.
She got into that.
Yeah. All right. So notification under VAWA.
Mm-hmm.
As you all are aware, and I think some folks have already brought this up in the previous session, you do need to provide a notice of the VAWA housing regs and the HUD certification form to applicants and tenants at three critical times in particular. You can do it more than this, but this is like the bare minimum. At the time the applicant is denied residency, at the time the individual is admitted into the complex, and any notification of eviction or termination of assistance. So those three critical times the forms need to be provided. So I don't think we need this anymore. Oops. During the 12-month period following the effective date of the VAWA 2013 regulations, which was 12/16/16, there was a special thing that you needed to do for those 12 months after December of 2016, but we're now in 2018, so we don't need to worry about this, and we should have deleted it. So don't think about it.
Don't think about it.
All right, so tenant, that concludes DB stuff. Do people have any other questions about anything we've talked about, with the, how to handle and respond appropriately to DB conflicts, both under Oregon law and federal law? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
With each lease violation that we give out, we also get 53 problem.
Correct.
So that and every resort now we have to do a 53
yeah.
Everybody.
And I think that's definitely best practices because of lease violation, even if it's not, you're not giving like a for cause notice at that point, but it's pre for cause notice, it could lead to a for cause notice. It's in the housing provider's best interest to give those forms more than not enough.
Okay, so to give.
And everybody's individual managers and property managers might have their own policies that are go beyond what we're talking about, right? So don't go back and tell your supervisor that we told you some that you're doing too much, that they don't need to require so much. A lot of housing providers do a lot more than what's required by the bare minimum. Yeah.
Sorry, I don't know if I missed that. Are landlords, all landlords required to provide them with this information up front, or is it upon request or suspicion or something like that?
So both the notice of VAWA housing rights as well as the certification form need to be provided at the time you deny a potential applicant, at the time the person leases up, and then any time you give a notice of eviction or termination of assistance.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's a lot of paperwork that keeps getting sent to that. It's for any housing provider dealing with any federal subsidy. Yeah. So if you're a private landlord and you don't have these subsidies, then you do not need to deal with it. And
but if you are a private landlord and you find yourself with an applicant who holds a Section 8 voucher,
yes,
then these do apply. So
Oregon
source of income protections mean you're going to run into some Section 8 holders. These protections do apply there. And the local housing authority is usually pretty good at providing forms and things like that for landlords dealing with Section 8.
Can you go back to that one? I was writing that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. So landlords still have to deal with tenant conflicts that are not domestic violence. And there are a lot of rules for what happens when it's domestic violence. But when it's not, I don't envy you for being in that position. There's not a lot of guidance. So what we can say is that some best practices are to make expectations known upfront, to have written policies that you provide to your tenants that move in about anti-harassment. And most, not all, but many communities have either neighborhood mediation services or community mediation services, mediation provided by the county, things like that. Encourage tenants to participate in those mediation programs. Ultimately, though, there are instances in which fair housing obligations can come up. And so the times that a landlord needs to be most concerned with this harassment is if it is based on a protected class. So if one of the tenants is harassing another based on that tenant's identity, and the identity falls under a protected class. And in Oregon, remember that protected classes are broader. It includes things like domestic violence, status as a survivor, and source of income discrimination. Those are covered under Oregon's fair housing laws. If harassment is happening based on protected class, then the landlord does have a duty to take some action and to take prompt remedial action reasonably calculated to end harassment. That's obviously a pretty broad catch-all. You have to do something about it, and you have to do it pretty soon. So these are going to be really fact-specific. It can often be difficult to figure out, you know, who the harasser, who the aggressor is, and what's going on, especially if the harassment involves disabilities, particularly mental health disabilities,
that can really muddy the waters and make it hard for a landlord to figure out. The best advice we can give is to take these issues seriously, to address them quickly, and to consult with legal counsel if you're concerned, because there is quite a bit of liability here for landlords who fail to act, and then their tenants suffer some heightened amount of harm due to the harassment. The other thing we wanted to mention was protecting tenant privacy. So each of you, your property management offices are going to have your own policies about records and retention and access to those things, but there are a couple of places where the law is very specific about tenant rights to privacy. One of those is with VAWA documentation, and like I mentioned earlier, Oregon law also has the verification of domestic violence that's provided. That's also protected. Landlords are required to keep that information confidential. The other is EIV data, the income verification system. There are strict rules about accessing that program and security of that program. That information is required to be kept confidential. And in general, it's a best practice in order to minimize conflict in your properties not to identify tenants who are accusing other tenants of harassment or of other issues that implicate that tenant. It's best whenever possible to keep those tenants' identities protected in order to prevent escalation further. So next we want to talk about marijuana use, another tough one, because we have federal laws and state laws that are in conflict. So within the context of employment, the Oregon Supreme Court has addressed this, and they say that Oregon's medical marijuana program doesn't get to trump the federal laws controlling illegal drugs. In general, in the law, if there are conflicting laws between the federal government and the state, federal laws trump state laws. And so that's what the Oregon Supreme Court has held is the case with Oregon's medical marijuana program. And I think that we can probably fairly extend that now to Oregon's legal recreational marijuana program. So the Bureau of Labor and Industries is the administrative agency that investigates claims of discrimination both in employment and in housing. Based on this decision, in an employment case, Boley has now decided that they will not investigate housing discrimination claims involving failure to allow medical marijuana use by tenants either. So at least the administrative agency in this state is extending the Supreme Court's ruling in this employment law case to now housing cases as well. Any questions on marijuana use? Tenant confidentiality, anything I just talked about there. Yeah.
I have a question. How, like in our lease, it's under suspicion of medical use or drug use, but I had one PM tell me, well, we're not police and you're not trained to smell marijuana. So how do we...
You know, so for me, that looks like any other factual dispute that a landlord and a tenant might have. If you decide that you're going to take action based on your suspicion, you're going to find yourself in court having to prove that suspicion. If you don't have enough evidence to prove your suspicion, you might consider not bringing an action and putting yourself in court where you would have to pay attorney fees if you lost.
I had a low-income housing subsidized, basically, housing. I had a tenant who, on inspection, had marijuana plants growing in their closet. And they asked, when I said, after conferring with my supervisor, said, well, let's just see if they'll be agreeable to getting rid of them. And subsequently, they got really upset about everything. And they said they demanded in writing the policy that said they cannot grow marijuana plants in their apartment. And, you know, we didn't have anything specifically saying that. But it seems like the language in the lease that said anything that's illegal federally, we would say, you know, and since there's federal funds, we'd say, you can't do that.
Yeah, so talking about an instance in which someone's growing marijuana in the apartment, and landlord says, no, you can't do that, and tenant says, show me the policy. I think you're right. If you have a lease agreement that says you won't violate any federal, state, or local laws, you probably have a hook there. Beyond that, you know, there's plenty of room for nuance in that discussion, but I think pointing to a provision in the lease that says you will not violate laws on the premises probably your best bet.
All right, so we're gonna change subjects now and talk about habitability, which is a big one in Oregon because it rains a lot, but for other reasons as well. So the habitability statute is divided under a couple statutes in chapter 90, but ORS 90.320 lays out the landlord's duties, which is a pretty long list. So we're just gonna go through that together. So landlord has a duty to provide habitable housing that's defined as effective waterproofing and weather protection. That's where mold issues come up a lot. Plumbing systems, sewage systems maintain in good working order, a water supply approved under applicable law, produces hot and cold running water, there's appropriate fixtures, it's connected to the sewage system, and also maintained in good working order. Adequate heating, always you see the maintained in good working order, so it's both at the time that somebody leases up and throughout the tenancy that most of these obligations are triggered. Electrical lighting with wiring and electrical equipment that was conformed to the applicable law at the time of installation. In Oregon, there's lots of old buildings, old houses who have so many electrical issues. And so that's, you know, that's one caveat for a landlord to be aware of. It's just at the time that that electrical system was installed or updated. So buildings, grounds, and appurtenances, we have that in brackets because it depends on whether you provide it. That are provided at the beginning of the tenancy, they need to be safe for normal and reasonable uses. So like elevators need to be safe to use. They need to be clean, sanitary, and free from all accumulations of debris, filth, rubbish, garbage, rodents, and vermin. This is a big one with rat issues in particular and bed bugs. So garbage and rubbish containers in clean condition and good repair, which the landlord must maintain and remove. Floors, walling, ceilings, stairways, and railings maintained in good repair. Ventilation, air conditioning, and other facilities and appliances, if supplied by the landlord, maintained in good repair. Safety from the hazards of fire, that includes a working smoke detector. If there's a carbon monoxide source, there needs to be a carbon monoxide detector. Working locks is a big one that we see a lot, especially in more rural communities. Latches for windows, and that applies to all tenants, all portions of the premises that the tenant's entitled to occupy, and then obviously keys for those locks. So that was a long list of things landlords have to provide and maintain, right? So what happens if you don't provide habitable housing? So first off, the tenant needs to request repairs, and that's kind of what triggers you to that your habitability duties may be implicated. If they've done it and you don't respond, that may be good cause for them to terminate the rental agreement, which is found in ORS 90.360, even if it's a fixed term lease. And it also can be a basis for a lawsuit if the landlord knew of or reasonably should have known of the condition and failed to make repairs. The lawsuit can include a request for injunctive relief, which really means forcing you to make the repairs, and for damages. Damages are based on reduced rental value during the period of violation, which can look back 12 months under Oregon law. A tenant could recover fair market value-ish. There's some debate about what the calculation is, but they can recover some money for any personal property that was lost or damaged, any personal injury that they have sustained, and any other related costs like substitute housing or food costs if they have a that's broken and landlord refuses to fix it. Usually the statute talks about reasonable time periods. So, lawyers can debate a lot about what's reasonable, and really what it comes down to is what would a judge think. So if it's 2 weeks, that's probably...
It would depend on the severity of the issue.
Exactly. Yep. Right. So if it's a fridge or a stove or an essential service that we're going to get into now, it's a heightened duty to deal with that quickly. So essential services, this is one of those terms that's defined in ORS 90.100 that we flagged for you at the beginning, that right at the beginning of the statute, it lists out every definition for all these words that have been defined. It's good to know those words. Essential services is defined as heat, plumbing, hot and cold running water, gas, electricity, light fixtures, locks for exterior doors, latches for windows, and any cooking appliance or refrigerator supplied or required to be supplied, and any other service or habitability obligation imposed, the lack or violation of which creates a serious threat to the tenant's health, safety, or property, and makes the dwelling unit unfit for occupancy. So essential services are things that are really, like, the way I think of it is, like, what do you need to survive on a day-to-day basis as a human? Probably fits within the essential service category. And if it's ever going to implicate a tenant's safety, it would also fall under this category. So 90.365 deals with the failure to provide essential services, which is related to, but in addition to, the failure to provide habitable housing. So in this case, a tenant has a right to obtain substitute services or housing if the landlord fails to provide them. They need to give written notice to the landlord specifying the breach and that they may seek substitute services if the landlord fails to address the situation. So the tenant has to give you a notice in writing letting you know that they think essential services are lacking and that they may seek substitute services. If they do that, landlord still doesn't repair it, they can then deduct the cost of the essential services from their rent. They don't have to pay rent while they're in substitute housing. They may recover from the landlord the actual and reasonable cost of finding substitute housing if it was more than the rent. And it's comparable housing, right? So if the tenant has a three-bedroom unit and you know, most tenants have a full working kitchen, a hotel that's comparable is going to be pretty pricey for that. And so that can add up pretty quickly. And so they're, during that time period, they're not paying their rent, and then they could be entitled to damages for that extra money they spent. And in the, under this category with essential services, if there is an imminent threat to health safety, the health or the safety of the tenant, they can terminate with just 48 hours. So fortunately for most of you who are dealing with subsidized housing, you are not going to, usually are not dealing with the more egregious habitability violations, and so you probably haven't dealt very often with a tenant who's going, has the right to terminate within 48 hours. But you might be dealing with a lot of other habitability conditions. So how do you figure out who's responsible, right? This is always the debate between landlord attorneys and tenant attorneys. So if the tenant caused, either on purpose or negligently, some kind of damage to the unit, they then can't get damages from you or force you to do something about it. And in fact, the landlord can bill the tenant for the costs to repair the damage that was caused by the household member or guest under the tenant's control. So this is similar language that you see with security deposits, right? It all turns on, was it the tenant's fault? Did they do it negligently or purposefully? So access kind of relates to habitability, but before we get into that, do folks have any questions about habitability?
Yeah. Kind of a statement. So the situation was, we do an HQS inspection every year for my program, and the unit failed for a stove not working, refrigerator not working properly, outlets had cracks and holes in them. We presented that to the landlord. She basically just overlooked it, didn't respond. Probably 30 days after that, she decided that she wanted to give him a 90-day notice. She gave him a 90-day notice. After he was out, probably, I don't know, a month later, she sends me an email of, not only so she did not even fix the repairs, but then she was trying to charge for those items, the stove, the refrigerator, and it was opposite of what our fail was. Our fail was like, the oven didn't work, the refrigerator was leaking around that, and then everything she said was extreme rust, you know. Mm-hmm. And so, and we did pay her for, you know, so we never stopped payment. Peter is on the very last day there. Mm-hmm. She took every bit of the deposit, and she's, you know, I don't remember exactly what she's requested, but that's a lot of information that I'm trying to get today to find out
Yeah, so that tenant, I would probably encourage them to consult with an attorney and see if they can be referred to their local legal aid office or whatever, because they may have some defections to those charges. And HQS requirements under the voucher program and other subsidized programs are usually a little more heightened than the habitability law, but they do kind of, they can track it in some regards.
Right.
Yeah.
I had a question about environmental growth or mold.
Mm-hmm.
How, if we sent in a specialist for, let's say, an attic that's just covered in it, and we can't figure out how to get that mold to go, and the tenant is becoming more and more sick from it, and reporting that they're becoming more and more sick, what is the next step as a landlord to cover everything to be able to help that tenant and to eradicate the mold if we don't know exactly where the mold's coming from? And the specialists that we sent in don't know about it either.
Yeah, so usually it was a mold specialist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We send
so
in
at that point,
specialist.
You probably want a contractor in. They're the ones that are going to be able to figure out, you know, what kind of structural issues are there that are causing the mold, if any. Mm-hmm. Mold specialists are good at telling you there's mold there and maybe telling you what kind it is, but that's
yeah, that's what we got, the environmental growth. But
yeah.
We also have a tenant who is becoming progressively ill, and her daughter is becoming progressively ill, and I'm wondering what I should do to help the tenant, because there is a personal property being lost.
Yeah, so that's a pretty sticky situation. I can't give you a whole lot of legal advice, other than to be aware of potential claims she would have under Chapter 90, as well as personal injury claims
outside of
Chapter 90.
But how do we eradicate it to be able to?
That's why you need to consult with a contractor and a lawyer to figure out what you can do to eradicate it.
Yeah.
One super helpful thing, regardless of the level of mold, is mm-hmm. just providing a high-functioning dehumidifier. They can be really helpful in our climate with dealing with mold.
Okay.
And in best case scenario, it's attached if there is a laundry unit in the complex.
Oh.
Okay. When there is, it's good to just attach them, and then they can auto-empty on their own.
Auto-empty the what?
The water into the connector to where the water from the laundry goes out.
Oh. Okay.
Then it's not on the tenant to have to empty it all the time.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
They don't like to pay for electricity for those either.
Yeah, which is fair. I mean, I don't know if they, you know, that's a conversation you can have with them. I'm not sure that it's going to increase electricity costs hugely, but it is something to be aware of, and it's, you know, it's on the landlord as well if a tenant is, if there is mold in a complex. There's lots of good info about mold out there. We didn't bring anything with us. I know that it can seem oftentimes like it's the tenant's fault, but in 95% of cases in Oregon, it's just the lack of insulation and poor quality, poor buildings, and insulation really being the biggest. And so putting it all on the tenant usually could subject a landlord to liability, because there are things going back to that waterproofing requirement under the Chapter 90 that can trigger a landlord's duties. So just something to be aware of. Yeah.
It's a high rise, 152 units, and we had an issue with the laundry rooms. And we ended up hiring, it was $500, we hired a company called American Leak Detection. They came out, they tracked the source of the water leak, and that was able us to then get a quote to repair it. We repaired it, and we're still in the process of addressing any kind of growth. But right off the bat, what we did was we had a contractor put up Visqueen, and you know, certain devices to control the air movement so that it wouldn't expose any residents any particulates. So that's just one thing as far as similar situations like what you said in the attic. And then a really common issue with the attics is gonna be when the bathroom vents vent into the attic and aren't ducted to the roof.
Exactly.
But they should
be. Or dryer vents.
Or the dryer vents, okay. So bathroom vents or dryer vents.
Yep.
Thank you.
All right. So we're going to move on to access.
I have a question about landlord responsibility. What if it's not a landlord's fault? We had a windstorm many years back in the dead of winter, and the entire street was out for 7 days. What responsibility does that landlord have at that point when
there were renters needing to get more charms because it was so cold in their units. What responsibility does a landlord have when it's natural gas?
What needed to be turned on?
So there was a windstorm. Electricity was out on the entire street for 7 days.
Situation, it's going to come down to how much control you have over it and what's reasonable, right? So if that happens and then it's 2 months later that you get somebody in to fix things, that may be less compelling than if literally people can't access the premises because the street's closed for a week.
Yeah.
Then that's a pretty reasonable response.
That's right.
Yeah, just curious. Okay, so access. You get a request for repairs, you need to go in and be able to repair, right? And then, so there's certain situations in which you need to give a tenant notice of entering. This is under ORS 90.322. So you can enter without notice only when there's an emergency and you need to get into the premises, and then you still need to notify the entry within 24 hours. If a tenant makes a request for repairs in writing within the previous 7 days, then you don't need to give a 24-hour notice to enter, unless the tenant specified the allowable time that they agree that you can enter. That was a change in the law a couple of years ago, so something to be aware of, which many tenants are not aware of. If they request repairs and it takes more than 7 days, then this provision would still apply if you're repairing the thing that they requested. So that is a big carve out of the law, but otherwise you do need to give 24 hours actual notice in order to access the unit. Actual notice doesn't mean notice in writing, but again, like we've said earlier, it's best to always do things in writing, keep a copy for your records, because then you prove that you complied. Landlords cannot abuse right of access or use it to harass a tenant. Inspections every other week, every two times a week, just for the sake of inspections, would probably rise to the level of harassment, especially if those inspections are not finding anything. If it's an unreasonable time that the landlord's seeking access, or with unreasonable frequency, and can deny access, they need to give the landlord actual notice. So again, they don't have to do it in writing, but best practice is for a tenant to do it in writing. And if a landlord is unlawfully accessing the unit, then a tenant can seek injunctive relief, just telling you to stop doing it, actual damages, or 1 month's rent. So, another thing that landlords deal with a lot, or can deal with, is hoarding. So hoarding is now a recognized disability. Since 2013, it became a part of, or was listed in the DSM, which is the Manual of Mental Disorders. So it's a psychiatric condition that produces symptoms such as a compulsive urge to acquire unusually large amounts of possessions and an inability to voluntarily get rid of those possessions, even if they have no practical usefulness or monetary value. Approximately 2 to 6% of the population is dealing with and diagnosed with hoarding. Usually happens to older adults, and there's often some sort of comorbid condition, which means they have some sort of other mental health disability as well. The items people hold on to often give a sense of comfort and safety, and getting rid of those triggers significant loss and grief. It's a really hard issue for everybody. Difficult for the tenant, difficult for neighbors, difficult for landlords, difficult for attorneys. The biggest suggestion we have, obviously there's concerns for the landlord, we know that. You're afraid of fire, you're afraid of health risks, if things are being kept in an unhealthy way, mobility limitations for the tenant and first responders. But we wanted to highlight, it is now considered a disability, it has been for 5 years. People can request reasonable accommodations, making referrals to DHS, Seniors and People with Disability programs, gatekeeper programs, if your community has one, might be a good option for a tenant who you're really trying to work with around this issue. All right, any questions about hoarding?
Yeah, question. A couple years ago, had a cockroach problem because someone went to a yard sale and brought back But now we've been very, you know, people have piles of clothes everywhere because that's a breeding ground. There's, you know, people that are hoarding. How do we, you know, because we don't want those cockroaches to come back and never completely get rid of them. Always going to be one or two hanging around. And we don't want the hoarders to have a perfect breeding ground for those. How do we go, and, you know, we've got housekeeping notices, you know.
Yeah, so I think the question, if I understand correctly, is just dealing with tenants who have brought different items onto the property, maybe has cockroaches on those or have encouraged the buildup of cockroaches, how to deal with that situation. And so giving notices is obviously the first step. If you are concerned about hoarding, making referrals to these programs, yeah, I don't have a whole lot of suggestions other than that. Making sure you have it in the lease, the requirements, you can talk to the tenant, point that out to them. Yeah, it's a hard situation. Any other questions before we change the subject? Sorry.
What about egress?
What about egress?
I mean, don't you have to have it though, around the windows and the walkways and all that stuff for state?
There's nothing I'm aware of in Chapter 90 that requires it. You might have specific requirements for your federal subsidy program or your local code.
HUD has egress, so I just was wondering about the state and federal regulations, if they coincide, so to speak.
So yeah, like I just said, there's nothing about proper egress in Chapter 90. It wouldn't be considered a bedroom, probably for counting purposes, if it doesn't have proper egress. Just under Oregon code, housing code. But Chapter 90 doesn't say, there's nothing in that list of habitability requirements about providing proper egress.
Well, and as far as hoarding goes, since it's now a disability, are you still allowed, because it's a disability, to have that happen?
Anytime you have somebody with a disability, you're juggling their rights as a person with a disability under fair housing law and your duties as a landlord.
That's
so
what
there's
I'm
never a perfect answer. And I couldn't tell you what to do in that situation, but yes, like we discussed, concerns about people being able to access the
land
is definitely a valid landlord concern in that situation.
But would we be held responsible if we allow this to occur?
Held responsible by who?
HUD?
Yeah, by HUD or anybody.
I can't say about HUD.
Or state regulations or federal
you
regulations.
You may be able to follow an HQ, pass an HQS inspection, but I would assume that you know, it really depends on this particular situation.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. And I think just one other note on hoarding. Like Megan said, fair housing is a huge, long training in itself. But ultimately, with hoarding, you'll probably find yourself in the situation of having to balance the rights of the disabled person and the needs of the disabled person to have an equal opportunity in housing with the administrative and financial burdens that it puts on your agency or your organization. And so if you are serving a termination notice or something like that based on the hoarding, knowing that hoarding is a disability, then, you know, people are going to have you're going to have to be prepared to make arguments about the undue burden that it's causing you. And within that, we generally encourage some flexibility in the reasonable accommodation process around hoarding, because it's going to be something, it's a behavior that reoccurs over time and requires intense mental health treatment in order to really make progress on it. And even with that commitment to mental health treatment, can still be a really difficult and recurring issue for folks. So even within the reasonable accommodation process, understanding that there is no limit on the number of reasonable accommodation requests that a disabled tenant can make, and it may be that you're having to address this issue further down the line. So ultimately, it'll be up to you and to your agency to figure out how and whether and when that creates an undue burden for you. So next thing I wanted to talk about was changes in ownership. And this part's actually relatively straightforward under Chapter 90. If a property is sold while tenants are under a lease, then the new owner, the phrase that we use is steps into the shoes of the prior landlord. So that means that the landlord who purchases the property is required to meet all of the obligations of the previous landlord under the rental agreement. So just like the previous landlord couldn't raise the rent during a fixed term tenancy or serve a termination notice, and no cause termination notice during a fixed term tenancy, the new landlord can't do that either. New landlord has all of the same responsibilities. That also includes the habitability stuff that Megan was just talking about. So if a landlord purchases a property that has a ton of habitability issues, then they have also purchased the liability that comes with that. So Oregon Housing encourages that at the time a new owner purchases the property, that they go ahead and enter into new rental agreements in the name of the new owner for low income tax credit program. But under state law, that's not generally a requirement. So one thing that comes up though with purchasing or a new landlord stepping into the shoes of an old landlord is rescreening. So sometimes a landlord will come into the property and say, you know what, it was the old agency that screened you and they had their own policies and their own procedures. We want to follow ours, so we're going to go ahead and rescreen everyone who's living here. What Chapter 90 says about screening tenants are that landlords can screen applicants, not existing tenants. And so once a tenant is admitted to housing, the idea is there's not really a need to screen. You can look at a tenant's past performance. That information should be available to you. You can look at the past performance of a tenant to know whether or not they will be a good tenant. And so if a tenant has lived at this property that you purchase or that you acquire and has not had issues, then that's going to be a good indicator that they're able to comply with their rental agreement. If the landlord has concerns about the tenant's ability to comply with changes to the rental agreement, like a rent increase or a rule change, that concern should be alleviated by the fact that a landlord can serve a termination notice if there's non-compliance or non-payment. So the idea that we are coming in and we're increasing rents or we're adding new rules, things like that, that's not necessarily a triggering event that should cause people to rescreen. If those new rules become an issue, then you have the right to serve a non-compliance notice or to charge a non-compliance fee after the second incident. So this issue is, it's still being litigated, it's still being explored, you know, how exactly we interpret the law. But the idea is that a lease provision requiring rescreening or allowing rescreening of an existing tenant is probably an unreasonable rule that would subject a landlord to damages owed to the tenant. So a landlord, we talked about earlier what kinds of rules a landlord can have. Landlords can have rules that relate to the use and occupancy of the property, so long as the purpose of the rule is to promote convenience, safety, welfare of the tenants, and to preserve the landlord's property. So in this case, rescreening is not going to achieve those ends because we already know about a tenant's ability to comply with the lease agreement based on their past performance. So in general, rescreening is considered a risky area, a liability area, if you choose to rescreen existing tenants.
All right, so we are moving to the last section, which is moving out and beyond. So the tenant decides to move out, or you decide it's time for the tenant to move out. How does that work? The first step, obviously a tenant can give you notice that they're going to end the lease or end the rental agreement. That's a pretty easy one, 30 days notice, there you go. Landlords, on the other hand, have lots of options for terminating a lease. We're going to go over most of them, not necessarily in detail, but just kind of termination notice is 101, so you're familiar with the lay of the land. This list shows them in quickest to longest route, so a 24-hour notice for outrageous conduct, very complicated statute that tenant attorneys love. Private tenant attorneys take these cases all the time because they can most
often defeat a landlord's 24-hour notice. Just to flag that for you. 48-hour notice. These apply to drug and alcohol-free housing, which is a very specific part of the statute, which we haven't touched on today. But that's a specific kind of notice that you can give if you're operating drug and alcohol-free housing. 72-hour notice, the most common, right? For non-payment of rent. Or a 144-hour notice can also be issued. So a 10-day repeat violation for a 30-day for-cause violation, if it's the same violation within the next 6 months since the 3014 was served, that's under ORS 90.392. It's not a curable notice. A 10-day pet violation for an unauthorized pet, this is a curable notice within 10 days, 90.405. And then no cause notices, right? So 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, depending on where you are, where the tenant is, more appropriately, and how long the tenancy has lasted. It's not curable. A 30-day for-cause notice with 14 days to cure, again, that goes back, that 10-day repeat is related to this one. And the second notice you give if it's the same violation within 6 months, and then sometimes it's no notice. Some landlords draft rental agreements that end at a specific time and they do not convert to a month-to-month lease by their own terms. All right, so there have been some recent changes regarding termination notices. I think most folks are probably aware of them. If you're in Portland, you do need to give 90 days notice for no cause notices. There have been amendments to the Portland reload ordinance that just went through in March, so be sure to be aware of those. 90 day notice of rent increase above 5%. Reload payments, which we're gonna get into shortly. And then damages are available to tenants if landlords don't comply with the ordinance. Milwaukee, anybody from Milwaukee?
All right.
Yes, tell them anyway.
A 90-day notice is also required for no-cause termination notices. There's also a damages provision in that local ordinance. Otherwise, everywhere else in the state, it's 30 days for a no-cause notice if it's been less than a year, 60 days for tenancies longer than a year. So you're going to give a tenant one of those notices, which we'll get into in more detail. How do you do it? You have to serve the notice, and there's very specific ways you serve it. Either personally, via first-class mail, adding 3 days to the time, or by posting and mailing if the rental agreement allows it. Posting and mailing allows you to not add those 3 extra days, but it has to be in the rental agreement that you can serve notices that way. Sometimes landlord thinks and tenants think it's better to send things via certified mail. That is not valid in service under Chapter 90. And it would be a strong defense for a defendant because it actually takes longer for things to get from to where they're going if you use certified mail. Termination period, how do you count them? So this is at 90.160. Notices that are calculated in days start running on the following day from the day you've given the notice and end at 11:59 p.m. on the date of expiration. So that's pretty important. Remember, you start counting. You wouldn't start counting today. You'd start the 30 days starting tomorrow. And notices that are calculated in hours, like a 24-hour notice, start running at the time of service in consecutive hours. Big picture, right? We want you to think about the collateral consequences of eviction. So many things that can happen to a tenant if they're dealing with an eviction. We want you to be aware of, because we care about tenants, right? But we also care about you and what you're going to be dealing with if you go to court. Also think about Section 8 voucher holders, that they will be dealing with mandatory termination if they're evicted from an assisted unit for a serious lease violation.
Just a point of clarification, affordable housing, you cannot give a no-cause eviction notice.
Correct. That is very correct for most forms of affordable housing, definitely tax credit property, which most of you are. The same applies for failure to renew. But for the few private landlords here, if you're renting to a Section 8 voucher holder after that first year, a no-cause is allowed. And if there's no subsidy involved, then no-cause notices are currently allowed, except for in the city of Portland where they are allowed, but you need to think about reload benefits, which Rebecca's going to talk about right now. So I understand there are relatively few
Portland landlords in the room, but we're going to go over this stuff for the folks who are in Portland, managing properties in Portland. And then I think it's also important for landlords to know in general, because already tenants advocacy groups have been working on some kind of statewide law that would model after the Portland relocation ordinance in order to protect tenants from the expenses that come with receiving a no-cause eviction notice. So the city of Portland has just made their relocation benefits ordinance permanent. It was a temporary measure passed in response to the housing crisis that we're facing in Portland. That was made permanent as of March 7th. So it applies to tenants who rent in Portland and receive either a no-cause termination notice, a rent increase of 10% or more in 12 months, or who fail to have their leases renewed at the end of their lease term with similar terms. And the amount of relo that a person is entitled to depends on the size of the unit. So it ranges from $2,900 to $4,500 depending on the size of the unit. Now, if a landlord is obligated to pay relocation benefits because they've taken some kind of action that triggers this ordinance, and they fail to pay that relocation assistance, the tenant is entitled to damages that include the relocation benefits plus 3 months rent plus any court costs, attorney fees that they accrue in enforcing this relocation ordinance.
Is that, say you have a three unit and you have three people living in it, is it $4,500 per person?
So the relocation benefit is per household or per unit. So if there are three people, three roommates living in a three bedroom unit, you are only obligated to pay the $4,500, and it's up to the tenants how they divide that. Okay, so it applies to no cause notices, and there are different rules for how relo benefits get paid depending on what it is that triggers the need for relocation benefits. Because remember, it can be the termination notice, the rent increase, or the failure to renew a lease, a fixed term lease. So if it's based on a no-cause notice, then the landlord automatically, they give their no-cause notice, it's 90 days because they're in Portland, and at least 45 days, so at least halfway through that notice period, they have to pay the relo benefits to their tenant. So it's self-executing, they must pay it, otherwise they're in violation of the ordinance. But it's a little bit different for folks who receive a notice of a rent increase over 10%. So to be clear, when I talk about these rent increases over 10%, that's in a 12-month period, not in a calendar year. So it's a rolling month-to-month, 12-month period look back. So that means if you give a 5% rent increase notice and 6 months later you give another 5% rent increase notice, you have triggered a relocation assistance case. In those cases, a tenant can choose to accept the rent increase notice. So if they get a 15% rent increase notice, they can say, you know what, the housing market out there is rough. I don't know where else I would go anyway. This is right next to my job. I like where I live. Whatever it is, they can choose to stay there and to pay the increased rent amount, and then they're not entitled to the relocation benefits because they don't have to relocate. But if a tenant receives the rent increase notice and says, I can no longer afford to live in this place, I'm going to have to move because of the size of this rent increase notice, then at that point they must notify the landlord in writing within 45 days that they intend to terminate their rental agreement. This is not the same as giving them a written termination notice. So the tenant does not have to supply the termination notice at that point in time. They just have to let their landlord know that they plan to terminate their rental agreement and they want to receive relo benefits. They actually don't even need to say that they want to receive relo benefits. The landlord is then obligated to pay the relocation benefits within 31 days of the tenant's request. And these timelines are important here. It's something that landlords and tenants in coalition worked really hard to figure out the timeline, because ultimately the relocation has to be paid early enough in the process that it's useful to the tenant, that they can use it to find another place to lease up. So that's where we get these timelines. If a tenant says to the landlord that I'm planning to terminate the rental agreement, go ahead, give me my relo money, they take the relo money, they cash that check, they then have 6 months from the time that the rent increase went into effect to move, to give their notice and start the vacate period. And if within 6 months they aren't there, then they are obligated to pay the relocation assistance back to the landlord.
If they stay?
If they change their mind and decide to stay and start paying the increased rent amount, then they have to pay the relocation benefits that they received back to the landlord.
Do they still have to give a 30-day notice as well? Say, hey, I did find a place, I'm going to use this reload, and then give 30 days, or can they just leave in the middle of the night after they've got their...
No, so if at the time here, where they notify their landlord that they intend to terminate the rental agreement, if they don't provide the actual termination notice at that point, they still do have to provide it later down the line.
And what about if it's a, you know, I've run a senior disabled, I've had seniors call me, my rent just went up, new owners bought the place, my rent is now $1,200, and I'll bring, you know, $1,000 home, but in, you know, Bedford area, so it's not important. Would that still in Portland be the same, you know, it's a new owner and they increase the rent?
Yes, so in Portland, well, anywhere in the state, the new owner steps into the shoes of the old owner, and so if they're taking action that would have triggered relocation assistance from the old owner, they are now responsible for it. And that even includes that if the old owner gives a rent increase notice, and while those rent increase notices are out there pending, a new owner takes over, that new owner could still be on the hook for relocation assistance, even though the old owner was the one who gave the rent increase notices. Yes?
In a situation where a tenant has a voucher and they pay a third of their income towards the rent, so maybe their rent's $100 or zero maybe, but the overall rent of the apartment is $1,000, and they're renting, the rent is increased from $1,000 to $1,100, so a 10% increase. But you don't necessarily know if their portion is going to change at all. Would the reload kick in?
So there are a list of exceptions that we're going to talk about, exceptions to who has to pay this reload, and one of them is subsidized housing. So subsidized housing providers do not have to pay relocation benefits. I'm going to double check the ordinance on how it deals with Section 8, though. I have a copy of it with me, so I'll take a look at that, because I don't think that applies to Section 8. Sorry, could you remind me of what your question was?
Well, just the two scenarios, one scenario and then a subsequent scenario. One being, if you're increasing the rent on the apartment by 10%, but they don't pay very much money, and you don't know how that's going to affect them, that's going to be determined by the housing authority. So maybe their portion doesn't change at all. So that's one scenario. But then there's a scenario where you do this increase and then the housing authority decides, well, yeah, we're going to make them, instead of paying $100 rent, we're going to have them pay $150 rent. And so that's a 50% rent increase to the tenant. So those are the scenarios.
Yeah, so we'll double check. I'm pretty sure that the reload does apply to voucher holders. So they're kind of their own little unique land of subsidized housing, right? And so if a private landlord gives a voucher holder an increase more than the more than 10%, then RELO is triggered. It doesn't matter who's going to pay what portion of the rent. In the same way with any part of Section 90, if a tenant is entitled to, you saw that a lot of damages are like 3 months rent. It doesn't matter if the tenant's rent was $15, they would get that full market rent.
Wow. Right, so for the purposes of whether RELO is owed, it's based on the total rent, not the tenant's portion of the rent. But we'll double check on the Section 8 carve-out.
And then for your second question, if the housing authority approves a rent increase and the tenant's rent goes up $50 and it's a 50% increase, that isn't what would trigger it. It's the notice from the landlord.
Okay.
Other questions so far about this relocation assistance? Okay, so the landlord, and this is one of the newer parts of the ordinance that was passed, the landlord has to give the tenant notice of the rights and obligations and the amount that they would be eligible for in relocation assistance with any termination notice, with any rent increase notice, and with any payment that they make under the relocation assistance ordinance. So even if they're already making the payment, the landlord's totally compliant and they're following all the rules, they still have to provide that notice at the time that they make the payment. The landlords are also required to notify Portland Housing Bureau of a few things. So Portland Housing Bureau is collecting data and landlords are required to notify them of any relocation assistance payments made to tenants. They have 30 days from the date that they make the payment to report that to Portland Housing Bureau. That part doesn't go into effect until May 1st, but Portland Housing Bureau already has the website up where you can report these payments as you make them, and you will be required to report them within 30 days beginning May 1st. This is a long list of exemptions. These are sort of the carve-outs from RELO, week-to-week tenancies, tenants who live with their landlords, who live in the same duplex as their landlords, live on one side, landlords on the other, or who live in an accessory dwelling unit where the landlord lives on the property. And then there are also some like sabbatical tenancy rules, so tenants who are renting the landlord's home while they're gone for 3 years or less, or while they're gone due to active duty military service. A landlord who's terminating a rental agreement so that an immediate family member can move in, and the family member is required to move in within 6 months of the termination. Housing that's regulated as affordable housing for 60 or more years. A unit that is not habitable due to action or inaction of the landlord or tenant. So lightning strikes and the building burns down and so landlord gives a notice. That's not something that triggers relocation assistance. And then where there's been a demolition permit prior to leasing up and the lease is less than 6 months, or where a landlord notified a tenant before the tenant leased up of intent to sell or convert the unit. Then when that eventually comes along, that tenant is not entitled to relocation. One big one that was sort of a contentious one, previously this ordinance also exempted landlords who owned only one property in the city of Portland or who leased only one property. That exception is now gone and it was replaced by this one here. So it's only for tenants living in the same duplex, an ADU, or in the same home, regardless of how many other properties the landlord does or does not own. But just having an exemption isn't enough. Like I said, Portland Housing Bureau wants some documentation on these things. So if you meet the criteria for an exemption, then you must fill out a relocation exemption application on the Portland Housing Bureau's website. And you must wait until you receive an acknowledgement letter from the Portland Housing Bureau. And then you must provide a copy of that exemption acknowledgement letter to the tenant before taking the action that would trigger RELO. And so best practice is if this is a unit that has an exemption, get that done early on because ultimately you still have to do your 90 days notice period for rent increases or for evictions, and you need this stuff lined up before you can take those actions and start your 90 days.
All right, so done with RELO, back to statewide issues. You've decided you're going to terminate, you've figured out which kind of termination notice you're going to give, and maybe you have given it or you haven't, but you just really are sick of this tenant and you want them out. You cannot unlawfully oust them, as I'm sure all of you know. So you cannot unlawfully remove them, you can't change the locks, you can't diminish services, like turn off the lights, turn off the water, or attempt or even threaten to do any of the above. Say like, you know, we hear of landlords saying, if you're not out in 10 days, I'm gonna change the locks. That's not the way it works, unfortunately, for landlords. Tenant remedies, they can seek injunctive relief, telling you to stop doing that and that they have possession and are entitled to possession. They can terminate the rental agreement and they can recover damages in the amount of 2 months' rent or twice the actual damages. So you don't oust the tenant, but you've given them a notice and they're still there. The termination date has passed. You're gonna be most likely dealing with the eviction process, forcible entry of detainers in circuit court or in some counties justice court. So ORS 105 is a separate statute, totally different than Chapter 90, but it has the procedure for evictions. So it's something to be aware of. We're not getting into detail in it today because it just would be too much. But and I do believe we'll be sending out a copy of the PowerPoint. The OHCS will send out a copy, so you can look at this as just like a table of contents so that you can, you know, be familiar with the whole process and procedure for filing evictions and navigating eviction court. Once you've filed an eviction, either in justice court or in the circuit court for your county, the tenant will get the summons that everybody will know when the first appearance is. That's the first court date. First appearance is usually set 7 days from the date the landlord files, or at most 7 days, depending on the county. And first appearance, that's the time most eviction cases settle. The vast majority of eviction cases settle at first appearance. Different things can happen there. If one party doesn't show up, including the landlord, then the other party wins by default. You may settle, which we'll get into, or the tenant doesn't want to settle, thinks they have a defense, and they will then file an answer by the end of that day. And they'd have to pay a filing fee or get a fee waiver or deferral. Similarly, when you file your eviction complaint, you also have to file or pay the filing. Trial is usually set within 7 to 14 days from the date of first appearance. This is unlike any other area of the law. It is a super fast-tracked process. It's kind of insane, really, and a lot of other states don't have their eviction processes move so quickly. But sometimes trial can get set out if the parties agree, especially if attorneys are involved and the court approves it. So like I was saying, first appearance happens. Most cases settle. The things you're going to be deciding on is the tenant vacating? Or are they just paying back rent? Who gets possession? Does the tenant get to stay in possession if they do A, B, and C? Is the tenant entitled to any money because of counterclaims they may have for habitability violations or other kinds of violations under Chapter 90, including unlawful fees? If it doesn't settle, then it gets set for trial. Trials are usually pretty brief. Sometimes attorneys make them last a lot longer, but usually they're quick. The landlord's burden to show that they have a right, that they're entitled to possession, right? And that they served everything correctly, they gave proper notice. If the tenant is asserting any counterclaims, which we'll get into, that's their burden to prove. So at trial, a tenant could win the eviction, and then they keep their housing, and the FEB is dismissed. The tenant could win counterclaims and keep their housing. They could also recover damages, get injunction for repairs, prevent discrimination, prevent retaliation, etc. If the landlord wins the eviction, then you would start the writ and the judgment of restitution. The tenant usually has 4 days to move out. Sometimes judges will give them longer. If they're not out by that date, then the landlord can file their writ, and then the sheriff at that point, once the writ is triggered, the sheriff would come and forcibly remove the tenant and stand by while the tenant vacates and landlord changes the locks. We're going to get into this shortly, but when anytime you have abandoned property on your premises, whether it resulted from an eviction or just from a tenant moving out on their own accord, there is a certain procedure you need to follow. But we're going to save that for the end. So, common defenses in eviction cases. Some of these, we're going to get into, some of these are specific to all types of evictions notices, and some only apply to certain notices. So we'll try to divide it up accordingly. Technical defenses apply to all notices. It can be bad service. You sent it by certified mail. Incorrect timing. You didn't give them enough time. Incorrect money amounts, especially on 72-hour notices, which we'll talk about in more detail. A tenant could have a retaliation defense, which is under ORS 90.385 that we'll get into. They could have discrimination counterclaims that you've terminated. We talked a lot about with domestic violence. If you terminate because the victim is a domestic violence survivor, they may have a discrimination counterclaim against you and could win the eviction case if they prove that. Waiver, which we'll touch on briefly, is a very complicated technical defense, but essentially the idea is a landlord has waived their right to evict based on a certain violation because they waited too long, they accepted rent, they accepted performance that varies from the terms of the rental agreement. So essentially saying, I've foregone my right to enforce this lease or this particular provision of the lease.
Or a tenant might be able to maintain possession. Another common defense they have is that they owe me so much money for habitability violations or unlawful fee violations, and that offset the rent that I owe, and therefore I am entitled to possession. So, getting into some of these in more detail, first is retaliation, 90.385. A landlord may not retaliate by increasing rent, decreasing services, serving an eviction notice, threatening eviction, or filing an eviction case if a tenant makes a good faith complaint to the landlord about the tenancy. For example, they ask for repairs. Maybe they complain to code enforcement in their local jurisdiction. If they join or organize a tenants' union, if they testify against the landlord in court. Sometimes, especially with neighbor-to-neighbor disputes, a neighbor might get subpoenaed to testify on behalf of the landlord or the tenant. If that neighbor says anything bad about the landlord, that cannot be a reason to evict that particular witness. If the tenant has won an eviction court against the landlord within the last 6 months, they prevailed already in FUD court and their defense was not just a technical defense, then that the landlord can't retaliate by getting another notice. Or if they do anything or say something to assert their legal rights as a tenant under any type of law, local, state, or federal. So retaliation can both be an affirmative defense. You can say, you're not entitled to possession because you retaliated against me, and it can be a counterclaim, which means they can then seek their own damages if they prove it. Damages are 2 times the rent or 2x the actual damages. There's an important case to be aware of from 2013 called Elk Creek Management. That case just essentially where there's 2 big takeaways. A tenant needs to prove that they wouldn't have been retaliated but for their protected activity. But for means like essentially, had they not done this thing, had they not joined a tenants union, you would not have given them the notice. So there needs to be a causal link between the two actions. If there's 2 causes, right? Say they joined a tenants union and landlord just wants to, they're trying to get everybody out because they want new people in. I don't know. If there's 2 causes like that, pardon?
They're remodeling,
right. That's the real reason they want people in, out. It has nothing to do with the tenant joining the tenants union. Then the tenant just needs to prove that the tenant's protected activity was the sole or dominant reason for the landlord decision. They don't have to show that it was the only factor. They could show that it was a material and substantial factor in the landlord's decision. So a big one, but not the only one. So retaliation, does anybody have questions about that defense or claim? It can be its own lawsuit for retaliation. Sometimes tenants can assert that after they moved out. Any questions about that?
Yeah, well, kind of, I need to understand it that, so there is a long-term tenant in a dilapidated building and they've been slowly but surely doing little fixes here. They just recently gave a no-cause eviction for 90 days because they are gonna sell the building they wanna remodel. So is that something that they could, because they're on a fixed income, they don't have any subsidized housing, they are just at a loss in the housing market and complicated, like I'm sure in New York and like Union County is pretty bad.
Mm-hmm.
And we know the reason why they're gonna do that is because she wants to either remodel or something, which she's been trying to do for a couple of years.
Yeah, I think in that case, it depends on when was the last time the tenant asked for repairs. If it was the day before the notice is given, that gives them a much stronger claim showing this, yeah, you were gonna remodel, but really what triggered it was the fact that I asked for repairs,
right,
or did whatever protected activity.
Okay.
So timing of their protected activity is a big, big factor in determining whether it was retaliatory or not. But yeah, when there's 2 causes, honestly, judges don't love retaliation defenses, and so landlords are in a better situation. If they can come up with a valid reason, those go far. All right, so waiver. Like I said, this is a very technical defense and something I encourage you to talk to your attorneys about, but it's good to be aware of. In big general terms, a landlord waives the right to terminate the tenancy when they accept rent for more than 3 rental periods with knowledge of the violation. So say you're terminating because of an unlawful pet that you found out about last August. You accepted rent all through the fall and winter, and you knew about that pet. A tenant would have a pretty strong waiver defense that now you don't get to suddenly enforce this lease provision and evict me because I violated it. If you accept rent for a period beyond the expiration of the termination period, can also trigger a waiver defense. And accepting performance that varies from the terms of the rental agreement can also trigger a waiver defense. So if rent's due by the 1st, but you've always accepted it on the 15th, that is performance that varies from the terms of the rental agreement, and you most likely have waived. There are certain times when a landlord doesn't waive. This is 90.414. It's a very detailed statute, but if you refuse the rent after the termination notice is up and you say I can't accept your rent, or you refund it within 10 days, that is not accepting rent. If you give a warning notice about the violation, and then the tenancy may be terminated if they continue to do that activity. If you accept partial payment of rent, that can trigger some arguments, but if you give that, essentially if you accept, following acceptance of partial payment of rent, the landlord gives a non-payment termination notice for the unpaid balance. In terms of 72-hour notices, that would not be waiver. If you accept partial rent after giving a termination notice where the parties agree in writing that the payment and the tenant breaches, that those things aren't waiver, then that would get you. You avoid a waiver defense in that case, but it does need to be in writing. If a lot of landlords require first month rent and last month's rent at the time of lease up, right? That wouldn't be waiver if you've accepted last month's at the beginning of the tenancy. And the landlord can never waive with a 24-hour notice. So again, this is a pretty complicated area of the statute, perhaps the most complicated in Chapter 90. So it's not something you should feel like you need to walk away understanding completely, but it's just something to be aware of, that there are times that you can waive your right to terminate based on your specific actions with that tenant and how much knowledge you had. So notice defenses. This is a big one that applies, like we talked about, did you serve it properly? Did you count time properly? And then there's some that are specific to certain types of notices that we're gonna cover. So a 72-hour notice. It needs to state the amount of rent actually owed. So did you state it? Did you calculate it correctly? That's a common defense that tenants have. Did you wait to send the 72-hour notice until after the 8th day of the rental period? If you sent it on day 5, 6, or 7, that would be a defense for the tenant. Did you actually give 72 hours notice at a minimum? Or more if you sent it by mail? Did you state clearly that the tenant has a right to pay to avoid termination or cure the notice? And does the notice demand late fees or other charges that aren't rent? It needs to be very clear how much rent is actually owed. So those are pretty common notice defenses with 72-hour notices. Like we said, this is the most common notices landlord gives and the ones you probably get the most practice at. So just be aware of those potential defenses. No-cause notices, these honestly are the hardest for a tenant to deal with. Is there any technical defense? Did they not count the time correctly? So were they entitled to 60 days and the landlord only gave them 30, or they did less than the 60? Do they have any kind of retaliation defense or counterclaim, a discrimination defense or counterclaim? And for most of you, can they only be evicted for cause? Is it subsidized housing? In which case, they can't get a no-cause notice. Any questions about these two types of notices, 72 and no-cause? Yeah.
Is it true that the landlord can be compelled to give the reason for the cause in the no-cause notice?
A landlord, there's a spot on a lot of the forms that say, notice is not required, but a landlord can choose to do it, and then they write it in. Then that's up to them if they're going to write it in.
I thought sometimes a judge might, ask.
No.
Kind of canceling out the no cause.
Okay.
No, judges never ask. All right, 30-day notices. So this is a 30-day notice for cause. One of the most common, really second to 72-hour notices that you're dealing with in subsidized housing. So is the lease violation in the notice specifically stated? Is it clear what they've done, and have you listed out the lease, the particular lease requirement, and the facts, and the way in which they violated the lease? Were they given an opportunity to cure within 14 days? Is at least one possible remedy stated on the notice? Does the tenant have any discrimination defenses? Can they submit a reasonable accommodation? The law is pretty clear that reasonable accommodation requests can be submitted up until the time of judgment. So it doesn't matter if you've given a notice and then you get an RA, you still need to engage in that interactive dialogue. And facts. Those are super important to for-cause notices. If you're going to allege something that happened, you want to have some idea that it happened, right? You want to be able to prove it in court that it actually happened. And so getting that those facts correct in the notice is pretty important, and if you don't, a tenant may have a pretty strong defense. So 10-day repeat violation is the next, it's in the same section of 90.392. But like we said, if you give a 30-day notice and the tenant cures within 14 days, if you have to give another notice in the next 6 months for that same, substantially the same violation, then you could give a 10-day notice with no right to cure. So a big defense is the alleged repeat violation the same or substantially the same violation that was in that 30-day notice? Both of those notices are gonna, you need to have served them correctly, calculated time correctly. You need to be able to prove the facts under for both of those notices in court. And was it within 6 months? If it was 6.5 months ago, then you wouldn't be able to issue a 10-day notice and a tenant would have a defense. Any questions on the repeat, the 10-day repeat or the 30-day for cause? Those are probably the most frequent ones subsidized folks deal with. Yeah.
So like for the same cause, if someone was breaking the law, but with two different, like someone was stealing packages and then someone trying to break into somebody else's apartment, they're still breaking the law. And would that be kind of the same if they decided to do something else to break the law? Or does it have to be, you know, she tried to break into the apartment again, or she tried to steal another package from somebody?
Sure, yeah. So the question is it the violation that needs to be the same? So if the first violation was breaking the law in one way and the second violation is breaking the law in a different way, is that enough? The statute says substantially the same act or omission. So I read that as the action of stealing packages would need to be, maybe another stealing situation would be the same, but maybe some other kind of crime isn't the same. But this is the thing that attorneys would love to argue about. So, yeah. Any other questions about 30-day for causes and 10-day? All right, so 24-hour notice. These are for outrageous conduct, serious, super serious conduct. Like, the way I think of it is, like, you need to get this person off your premises because of how extreme and how dangerous their behavior was. So it's a really high bar to prove. So you need to have the facts, you need to be sure that they are, it rises to the level of that statute. There's a lot of different case law on what is outrageous. There's a recent case where a tenant had a psychotic break and acted as if he was the landlord and started giving out notices that rent was being reduced to lots of folks in Mobile Home Park. He didn't go to the whole park, but he did get a certain number of notices out. He then recovered from that psychotic break, did not do anything about the notices, so didn't try to rescind them or tell the landlord. And the Court of Appeals, Oregon Court of Appeals, found that was not outrageous conduct. So that is a pretty high bar. The criminal piece maybe is a little bit easier, that's, you know, because it tracks criminal statutes more. But if you have behavior that doesn't rise to the level of criminal behavior, you might have a hard time getting them out on a 24-hour notice. And of course, there's discrimination defenses a tenant can assert. Was domestic violence at issue? This is a big piece that Rebecca was talking about earlier. Are you actually evicting the survivor and not the abuser? Any fair housing defenses outside of DV land? Any reasonable accommodation requests? Questions about 24-hour notices? All right. So, counterclaims. This is a big one that we've alluded to a couple times. It's a big way that a tenant can maintain their tenancy, maintain possession, or recover money damages. So the right to counterclaim must be provided by statute. Essentially, anything in Chapter 90 is gained in eviction court, as well as any discrimination defenses. So a big thing that comes up both in FEDs for non-payment of rent and in other cases, because of some recent case law, if a tenant wins damages for reduced rental value and they've paid rent into court, and they can prove that prior to filing, the landlord knew about these habitability conditions or the other unlawful behavior, and they prevail, they win, then they will maintain possession if they paid that full rent amount into court. So that's something to be aware of, that especially if there are any kind of not Chapter 90 violation, like unlawful fees, like habitability claims, the tenant may have a pretty strong counterclaim and be able to maintain possession, which might be another reason for coming up with a decent amount at first appearance and stipulating to something. All right, so that's the end of termination notices and evictions. Any questions about that? I know we went through it super quick. Nope? All right.
All right, we are in the final stretch here, folks. So, you have gone to court, you've gotten your judgment of restitution, or maybe your tenant just gave a 30-day notice and moved on. Either way, your tenant is gone, but their property is still there. What do you do? Comes up all the time. The statute that you're looking for is 90.425. It tells you exactly what you have to do. You have to give a written notice of abandoned property. If you think that property is worth less than $500, which often it is, otherwise it wouldn't have been abandoned in the first place, the notice must state that the value is under $500 and that if it isn't picked up, the landlord's going to dispose of it, throw it away. The notice must be either personally served on the former tenant or it must be sent to the forwarding address, if the tenant provided a forwarding address, or to the address of the rental unit in case they've set up mail forwarding through the Postal Service. Once that notice has been sent, a tenant generally has 8 days to respond. If you're in the scenario where someone has been personally served, you handed them or someone handed them a copy of this notice, then it's only 5 days, but otherwise it's 8 days to respond. The tenant can respond verbally or in writing. They're not required to respond in writing, although the notice is required to be in writing. Within that period. And if they respond, they have 15 days to pick up that property from the landlord. And so during that time period, the waiting game that the landlord is playing before they can get rid of this property, there are some requirements about the steps that they take to safeguard the tenant's property. So they must store abandoned personal property in a place of safekeeping and exercise reasonable care. They can't throw it out on the curb where it's going to get rained on, picked through, things like that. There are some exceptions. You don't have to wait 15 days to throw away the rotting food, to take out the trash that's sitting in the trash bin, or to call animal services to deal with pets or other animals that were left behind and that are at risk being abandoned there. If a landlord accrues costs for the storage, the removal of tenant's property, those costs can be passed on to the tenant. So that includes the costs for having it hauled away from the property, the costs for storage. In any case, we're looking at actual or reasonable costs. So you can't just decide, you know, that was a real pain, I'm going to say that was worth $500. You have to have actual or reasonable costs. But if your tenant contacts you within that 5 or 8 day period, then you must make the property available to them at reasonable times during that 15 days. If they don't contact you after the 15th day, you can dispose of it. There are different obligations, though, for landlords in manufactured home parks. When we're talking about like removals of RVs or mobile homes that have been left behind, where the landlord only owns the space and the mobile home actually belongs to the tenant who is left, and also with floating homes. So there are specific rules for that. If that's something that you deal with, make sure that you're checking on those rules. Security deposits. So at the end of the tenancy, you have 31 days to provide either a written accounting of how you use the security deposit or to return the security deposit. And if you're only returning part of the security deposit because you need to keep some for damage or for the tenant's failure to comply with the rental agreement for those damages, then you still have to provide an accounting for the amount that you kept, even if you don't keep the entire thing. Now, if a landlord fails to provide this accounting, fails to return the deposit within 31 days, or unreasonably withholds the security deposit, keeps more than they're entitled to, then a tenant is entitled to twice the amount that was wrongfully withheld, or twice the entire deposit. The landlord can claim from deposit costs, hopefully you all know this already, only to repair damage beyond reasonable wear and tear. And reasonable wear and tear is not something that's defined in Chapter 90. It's something that we have to use our good judgment about, and it's another area where attorneys love to argue about what is and is not reasonable. One source that we look to for some guidance on what might be reasonable wear and tear is IRS depreciation tables for folks who own rental housing, and those provide estimates of, well, those provide for tax purposes what the depreciation period is for things like carpets, for things like roads, the parking lot, things like that. So if you're not sure how long is a reasonable period of time for wear and tear before something needs to be replaced, you can check those tables. But also think about how long your tenant's been there. If you have a tenant who has been living in that unit for 15 years, 20 years, chances are there's not much that you can keep their security deposit for if you haven't been replacing carpets and painting throughout that tenancy. We talked a little bit earlier about costs to clean the carpet. That has to be in the rental agreement. They have to be actually cleaned both before and after. And then there are also, landlords also have the ability to claim the security deposit for defaults of the rental agreement. Usually it's a failure to pay rent. If the landlord is taking from the security deposit because there is damage caused by the tenant, the landlord does not have to make those repairs within 31 days, even though they have to provide an accounting. And in fact, the landlord generally doesn't have to make those repairs at all. So if the landlord decides that they will, you know, that there is a minor issue and it's something that they are entitled to charge the tenants for, but ultimately they decide not to make the repair, it's not going to be a habitability issue for future tenants, they have the right to do that. Essentially, they're being compensated for the loss of value of their property. But where a tenant owes the landlord more than the amount of the security deposit, then the landlord's in the situation of having to recoup that outstanding balance. And so there are a couple of options for landlords. The first one is to sue. And usually, for the types of damages that would result from the breach of a rental agreement or from damage to a unit, it's appropriate to sue in small claims court. Anything that's less than $750 must be brought in small claims court, but claims up to $10,000 can survive small claims court. It's an easier way to do it. Attorneys aren't involved, and it tends to be relatively quickly that this claim is processed. It also provides for mediation or attempts to reach resolution informally. So it can be a good process when you're trying to deal with recovering some of this money that might be owed to you. In order to file in small claims court, you have to have made genuine efforts before you file to settle the dispute. And you have to swear to that when you file your claim, that you have made genuine efforts to try to correct this and to resolve this dispute. You're not allowed to have your lawyer represent you in small claims court, with very few exceptions. and within 14 days of the service of the complaint, the tenant must pay, ask for a hearing, where, again, you're open to the possibility of counterclaims there, or if the amount is more than $750, they can ask for a jury trial. If a tenant doesn't respond, though, just like in any court case where the other party doesn't respond, you win by default. You win automatically. And then you will have a judgment against your prior tenant. That judgment is something that you can send to a collections agency. You also can skip this process and go to a collections agency, send the debt to them. There are some risks, though, to going to a collections agency without having first gotten a judgment against the tenants, because the tenants have the ability under consumer law to challenge or to contest any collections and to contest the basis for that. And then the other piece is that if these get too old, in general, Chapter 90 has a statute of limitations of 1 year. If you get beyond the point where you would be able to go to court and enforce this, then there's some question about whether, under consumer laws, you can still pursue collections of that debt. If otherwise, you would have no legal remedy to go after that money. Any questions on security deposits and small claims court and recouping those costs? So, in order to get a judgment against the tenant, you have to pursue those claims within 1 year.
Legally.
Right. Otherwise, you'll be barred by a statute of limitation.
And then, after the 31 days, they haven't provided a deposit accounting, how do you, does a tenant know about enforcing that? Who do they go to help them?
Yeah, so a tenant can also pursue their remedies through the small claims process. So they would be looking at twice the amount wrongfully withheld or twice the deposit. That's usually going to fall under the $10,000. So they can go to small claims court, not have to deal with attorneys as well. They also can call their local legal aid office for advice. All right, and then, go ahead.
Before you move on from the security deposit and accounting, can you charge besides for damages or repairs above normal wear and tear? Say a tenant left the apartment very dirty. So can you charge for cleaning?
Yes. So reasonable cleaning fees can be assessed if the standard that we use is that a tenant is supposed to have left the unit broom swept. So essentially they get everything out and you know they haven't left spills behind and things like that. But if it's because dust has gathered on the blinds and you didn't think they vacuumed thoroughly enough, probably not. So it has to be beyond
dirty refrigerator, dirty oven. I mean if it's beyond because it's been sitting in dust.
Yeah, so it has to be beyond sort of basic housekeeping standards in order to charge a cleaning fee. So that, like the reasonable wear and tear standard, has a lot of room for argument about what that looks like, and different people will have different standards of housekeeping and things like that. But that broom swept is the language that we use. With the passage of Oregon's source of income discrimination protections, the state also implemented the Landlord Guarantee Fund for housing choice voucher holders. So if you have Section 8 voucher holders that you rent to, the Landlord Guarantee Fund will help pay for damage that's caused, because that was a big complaint that was heard from landlords around the time that source of income protection went into place. Is, look, we get it, people with Section 8 vouchers need to have housing too, but at the end of the day, if they have damage, we already know they're not making enough income to provide for that, and so our properties are at risk. So this Landlord Guarantee Fund says that if a landlord is facing damage caused by a Section 8 voucher holder, they can go to small claims court or to the circuit court, but they need to go to court and get a judgment for the amount of the damage. And once they have done that,
they can bring that to the landlord guarantee fund, and they will be reimbursed for property damage, unpaid rent, and other damage caused as a result of the tenant's occupancy under the Section 8 program that exceed normal wear and tear, and that are between $500 and $5,000 per tenancy. That's the end of our presentation.
Wow.
Do we have questions? All right, well, we are right on time. Yeah, we got one question up front.
Of course.
With the 3014, with the cure, I'm just trying to go back because we're going to be and can you put in the cure cannot break the law? Because they have different.
So, the cure has to be reasonably related to what the actual violation is. And so, usually a cure for a violation of a particular rule or of a particular law is that they don't commit the same offense again within the next 6 month period. Beyond that, it
says, federal, state, and local laws not breaking them, so I was
yeah, I think that's sort of a nuanced piece. It's hard to say what would and would not pass muster there. And I think different attorneys would disagree on what that actually looks like. If folks have other questions, you are welcome. Megan and I will be here for another 20 minutes or so. You're welcome to come talk to us.